Welcome, everyone. We're so pleased to have you with us for the kickoff of the Sun Valley Forum Resilience Now Summer Series. I'm so grateful to all of our partners, friends, and advisors, and to all of you for joining us today. We are in the midst of a difficult moment in so many ways, and what we can all use, I think, right now is community. And we have an incredible community in the Sun Valley Forum world. So I'm excited to share with you our day's plans and the rest of the summer's plans and to hear from all of our incredible friends and colleagues. So first of all, I'm going to share a few slides to give you guys a quick overview. So with that, welcome again to the Sun Valley Forum. We're asking of you to be here as you always are at every year's Sun Valley Forum. And if you haven't been with us before, it feels like community. When you come, people are welcoming and looking to meet each other and find ways to accelerate the work that we're each doing in the world. And that's what we're working to recreate here with the Resilience Virtual Series this summer. If there's ever a moment when we need resilience and when we need community, it's now. So thanks again for joining us. We'll be talking about the moment we're in, of course, with an incredible local to global conversation about COVID-19, the pandemic, and what it has meant, this experience for us, for well-being and resilience. We'll be talking about what we're all working to do for the sustainable development goals, for the climate, for the planet, and for social justice. We've invited our very dear good friend, Jeff Rochester, one of our partners and advisors here with the forum since nearly the very beginning, to reflect during his update on what this moment has meant around the social justice challenges that we're facing and the kind of guidance he's sharing with other leaders around the world. I'm so grateful that Jeff's agreed to do that for us. Thank you. I do feel that this virtual world that we're in is a bit of an opportunity. It's an opportunity for this forum to be available to anyone who has access to the internet at no cost, and to hopefully bring more of the ideas, inspiration, and insights from our forum community to more people over time. Thank you again for joining us today. In addition, on July 28th and July 30th, we'll have deeper dive content-rich events. So these issues we've focused on for July 28th and 30th are again really pulling together the moment we're in, the pandemic, social justice, and our climate and environmental challenges and what they mean for all of us. So on July 28th, we have well-being in our food system, and July 30th, rebalancing the human relationship with nature. And really the topics we're going to be talking about, that transition of our food system to support well-being and more equity and opportunity and resilience throughout our well-being and food systems. That'll be on the 28th. Very relevant, as we've seen in this time of COVID, with the disruptions of our supply chains, of our food system. Here in Idaho, we've seen that front and center, where people have been plowing back in crops and dumping dairy, and also people who have been stepping forward. And our local food community has been doing an incredible job supporting each other and helping to fill in those gaps. But we're fortunate. We have a growing local food community and many don't. So we'll be digging into what are those strategies and opportunities for all of us, no matter where we are, to build a better food system for well-being and a better approach to beyond GDP. How do we think about well-being beyond short-term financial returns? And what are those innovative approaches to create systems that work better for all of us? On July 30th, we're going to be talking about rebalancing the human relationship with nature. Again, as we know, the pandemic's cause, the fact that we have more humans and more animals closer together, whether that's because of habitat loss and human encroachment on natural areas where our animal friends live, and also our industrial agricultural system, as we know, has been a cause of pandemics in the past with bird flu. And so, again, how can we rebalance that relationship of humans with nature? So we'll be digging into those strategies on July 30th, and we hope you all will join us for both of those. I also want to thank our partners. As a lot of you know, I have stepped down as executive director of Sun Valley Institute. I'm very pleased to have passed the baton to my colleague, Lexi Pragastis. And Lexi will be meeting us on July 28th. She'll be joining us. But in the meantime, Christensen Global Strategies has been my longtime advisory firm, and I'm really happy to be here helping to host this and helping to curate this once again. And then I wanted to thank Maggie Kaplan and her organization, Invoking the Pause, which is supporting climate challenge trailblazers, as you'll hear in her update. It's a fiscally sponsored project of Inquiring Systems, Inc. So thank you, Maggie, and thank you to Invoking the Pause. Pico Creek Productions, our very dear friend, Peter Horton, and his team. Thank you, Peter, for being here with us today to moderate our local to global conversation, for everything you give year-round to the forum and to the Institute as a member of our advisory board. Thank you. And then American Farmland Trust. American Farmland Trust is an incredible leadership organization, and we have been so fortunate to have AFT with us for 3 years now at the forum, and we'll be hearing from Sean Shepard during the update, as well as have them with us later this summer at our Wellbeing and Food Systems event on July 28th. Then I just wanted to share a little bit more about our day. So we have a few hours together. We're gonna keep it crisp and dynamic. I know it's hard. We're spending a lot of time in front of screens these days, and we've been thoughtful about how we've structured this for a lot of interaction. We have a combination of plenary events like the ones we're about to head into with our partner updates. And then we're going to have breakout sessions. We've highlighted those breakout sessions in blue in the slide. And so we'll have our first break and speed networking opportunity there. Then we're going after the networking. The speed networking is all available on the app, the Run the World app. And then we'll have campfire conversations hosted by our different forum partners. So I'm so excited that our forum partners have agreed to host these, and we're going to be assigning you randomly into those. So you'll meet new people and have the chance to reflect on what these past months have meant to you in your life and share with each other and connect more deeply. Then we'll have another break and some speed networking. Then we have our local to global conversation on health and resilience in this time of COVID with the amazing Peter Horton, Lisa Wing, the head nurse at Bellevue Hospital in New York, and Terry O'Connor, who's a doctor emergency room physician here at St. Luke's Wood River in our community, has been leading our emergency response as well. They'll have then we'll have simultaneous sessions. So we will have Q&A with Lisa, Terry, and Peter. So you can choose to go there. We'll have reception networking rooms hosted by our forum partners who are giving updates. And you'll see that in the Run the World program, who you can join and which session you want to go to for that. So that you can choose who you want to spend time with. And we recommend joining early. The first eight folks in the room will be on camera, and others will be interacting through chat. So, and then at the same time, if you don't want to go to a room and you want more kismet and more opportunity for meeting someone through our speed networking, it's a really wonderful, the speed networking, I really encourage folks, if you don't need to take a break, stay during the breaks, do the speed networking, because it's set up where it randomly connects you to somebody. Like if you walked into a cocktail party and it'll connect you with someone for 5 minutes, and then it'll move you on to the next person to randomly connect you with. So it's a really fun way. We chose the Run the World system in part because of this opportunity, because we felt like that was such an important part of the magic of the Sun Valley Forum. And then finally, we'll all come back together for a closing session and call to action, sharing what we've heard and where we're going for the future. And I've invited a handful of our forum partners to join me with that, to help share what they've seen in their breakouts and campfire sessions as well, and inspire us for what's coming next. So just a reminder, we have simultaneous networking sessions. So first of all is the campfire sessions. That's from 2:30 to 3:15, so right after our updates. We'll have a break, and then we'll go to these campfire sessions. And please email forum@sunvalleyinstitute.org. And I'll ask Mike to put that in the chat if he hasn't already. forum@sunvalleyinstitute.org. And please let Mike know if you'd like to join a campfire session. He'll get you randomly assigned. And then second, let him know for the reception networking rooms from 4:15 to 4:45. If you do want to join a networking room with one of our partners, please let him know which one you'd like to join. So finally, with that, we have, of course, social media. We have a hashtag Sun Valley Forum. We have Instagram at Sun Valley Institute, Twitter at Sun Valley Inst, and then Facebook, again, Sun Valley Institute. So please follow, tag, tweet, post, inspiring quotes, pictures of the screens, insights. We would love to engage a broader community in our conversation today. So finally, thank you again for joining us. I'm so excited to be here with all of you today and to hear from our wonderful partners now. And with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I'm going to welcome back our initial set of partners to join us to update. All right, let's see. All right. Welcome, everybody. So excited to have all of you here today. Edward, I just wanted to mention that there's the opportunity to download the Run the World app. So you can do it all on your screen and on your computer, but the app is also really helpful to connect with speakers and participants as well. And finally, during all the updates and all the sessions that we're in, don't forget to use the chat feature, like I see a lot of you are. So hi, Eamon, Amanda. So people are using that chat feature. Please definitely use that. And we'll be tracking questions along the way from everyone. And if we don't get to them here in these update conversations, we'll get to them during the later opportunities to connect with each other. I just heard a camera go off. I love that. Be sure to post. Thanks, you guys. So, welcome. So, we've invited about 12 of our longtime partners, advisors, people who are doing such incredible work in the world. And we've asked them to provide us about a 3-minute update, what they're up to, what they need, what they're and where they're coming, so that we can all learn from them and find ways to collaborate together. Our first person who's going to be speaking with us today is Mitch Anderson. And Mitch is the CEO of Amazon Frontlines. And Mitch was with us last summer for the first time, but I've actually known Mitch now for probably 12 years, I think 13 years, somewhere around that. Because of his incredibly good work working with indigenous communities in the Amazon. And Mitch is there in person. And Mitch, I have to just share a lot of gratitude to you because you, I know you all got sick and you're still joining us for a few minutes here. And I'm just very grateful that you're with us and for everything you do every day. And with that, I'll pass the mic over to Mitch.
Hey, thank you, Amy. And really good to be back with everybody. Wish that we could be doing this in person. I, like everybody, I think, is getting used to this virtual reality. I'm down here in Ecuador's southern Amazon, and you know, just a very quick update. You know, COVID-19 has hit indigenous communities very hard across the Amazon rainforest, and these are communities that are remote, some of the most vulnerable communities to sickness. Outside sort of the reach of the effective state and medical attention. So my organization has been working around the clock to partner with indigenous leadership across the upper Amazon, supporting their essentially capacity to govern their peoples and manage this crisis. And what that looks like is ensuring that they have the communications infrastructure they need to get information out into the villages, ensuring they have the health protocols that they can share with their communities, and then just basic food and medical provisions needed. You know, while at the same time really working with regional governments across the Amazon to improve their response and improve their effectiveness and make sure that there's testing happening, make sure that we can scale the amount of provisions getting out into communities. And then, you know, finally, really working to strengthen resilience in the communities. because as we know, when you have, you know, big economic depression like this as well, you know, the governments, companies are, you know, their default is going to be, you know, very hostile economic recovery packages that are going to affect Indigenous peoples, and going to affect frontline communities across the world, really. And we're seeing Indigenous communities preparing for this now. We're supporting them and ensuring as well that, you know, rights violations don't go unchecked during this time. So beyond just COVID-19 here in the Upper Amazon, we've seen, you know, terrible oil spills occurring as well, you know, at the same time. So communities literally living a nightmare within a nightmare. And, you know, have been very active. Our legal team's been very active in ensuring that these types of abuses don't go unchecked. And we're seeing a big uptick in illegal logging and mining right now. And you know, and across Brazil as well, just environmental agencies are getting gutted. And yeah, as Amy said, I've been down here in a Warani village over the last 100 days, and we actually just went through or are going through an outbreak of COVID-19 now. So pretty much the entire village got sick. I was sick for only a couple days last week and got better. So that's a good sign. And we're seeing that most of the communities here have been, you know, very strong, very resilient, and have, you know, relied on their traditional plant medicines to heal their bodies. And that's been really inspiring and powerful to see. And yeah, so thank you so much, Amy, for opening up this opportunity. Wish I could have shared some photos and stuff, but felt like it was too quick to try to do that. So thank you guys.
Thanks, Mitch. I know that you, your internet is iffy and you may need to leave here and there, but actually we did have one of our speakers, Hillary Franz, unfortunately isn't feeling well. And so I just wanted to mention that if you wanted to come back in after the presentations of our colleagues, I would welcome you sharing those if you'd like to. We'd love to give you each another minute because we gained a little bit of time with one of our friends, unfortunately not feeling well, but she'll be with us later in the summer. So if you want to, Mitch, that would be wonderful at the end, but no pressure, just let me know. And thank you again for all you do.
Thank you.
Really wonderful to have you with us always. Next is Maggie Kaplan, and Maggie joined us. Oh, hi, wait, we have to go back to Mitch, sorry.
you want to say hi to everybody? That's my little daughter, Amy. She's 5.
Hi.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you, Mitch. That was fantastic. So great. You know, I have to say one of the benefits of this virtual world we're in is we do get to see a little bit more of each other as we come in to each other's homes. So it can be really special. So thank you. With that, I'm going to introduce Maggie Kaplan. And Maggie was new to the forum last year for the first time, and I'm so grateful that she's become such an important part of our community. I got to know Maggie on the bus to rafting, and Maggie, we've become friends since. I went to an event that she hosts, a small group of folks who are leading on climate solutions last fall, and just was so pleased to get to know how she approaches her work in the world and making a difference, and wanted to give her the chance to share a bit more about her approach as a philanthropist and a supporter in working to advance the work that we're doing in the world. Thank you, Maggie, for joining us, and to you and invoking the pause.
Yeah. Okay. I'm Maggie Kaplan, and I'm the founder and executive director of Invoking the Pause, an environmental small grants program now in its 14th year. We fund pauses, strategic and reflective pauses that give our climate change trailblazers funds to help explore their bold ideas about some climate strategies. We fundamentally believe that small is beautiful and strategic, and that cross-sector collaborations and communication are essential levers to advance innovative climate solutions. This year, all of us have experienced the planetary pause. As a result, I know I've become more introspective, and it's reinforced my belief that there is power in stillness and that my theory of change is on the right track. I've been struck by what has emerged from the stillness during shelter in place, some hopeful moments, where nature has proven adept at taking advantage of fewer people moving around, and that our deep global interconnectedness is visible as never before. But then, just as quickly, I'm struck by the chaos and pain swirling around us, the paralysis and the helplessness, and feel a deep desire to revisit how invoking the pause can make a larger impact to help further social justice goals inextricably linked to climate issues. We at Invoking the Pause have always been sector agnostic in funding climate work. So youth activists, documentary filmmakers, journalists, indigenous artists, regenerative agriculture practitioners, rainforest technologists, and corporate stakeholder advocacy efforts have recently been funded. This intersectionality seems even more critical now. We're currently discussing how best to deploy our assets, our time, talent, and treasure in light of the changing reality. And while we haven't finalized decisions beyond postponing our annual fall summit this year, we are leaning toward remaining focused on the small corner of the world where we can make the most impact with our trailblazing grant partners. In the past, we've launched a new funding cohort at the beginning of each year, and it may not make sense for 2021. So if not, what's the best way to redeploy those assets? We don't know the answers yet, but I know I'll gain some insights during our time together today. So if I ask for anything to advance our work, it's to ask each of us to dig deep when we can into moments of stillness amidst the chaos, to consider new ways to become who we need to be and who we really are, co-creators of a new reality, individual parts of a larger continuum of being. I know from experience that small ripples create larger ones and can help us accelerate toward a new normal, a post-growth, post-carbon paradigm in the days, months, and years ahead. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maggie, and thanks for everything that you do, and the organizations you support are incredible. So next we have Amanda Ellis and for a partner update. And last year at the forum, Amanda graciously hosted two sessions that she helped put together, one around women in leadership and another one around Ireland as models for resilience. And Amanda is herself a force for nature and of nature. She has an incredible bio, so I really encourage you to take a look at Amanda's background. We're very fortunate to have her with us as well. Amanda was New Zealand's ambassador to the United Nations in Geneva, doing all sorts of matters that take place there. And she's now executive director for Hawaii and Asia Pacific, as well as head of strategic partnerships for the Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability at Arizona State University. Amanda, we're so happy to have you with us and for your ongoing support, collaboration, and advice to all of us. Thank you.
Aloha, Amy, and fellow Sun Valley Institute fans. It's just so inspiring to be here. And from a place like Hawaii, where aloha is the greeting and the farewell, and means love and compassion. It's, I think, a very good reminder to us of the qualities that we all need during this terrible pandemic. I'm going to ask the wonderful Chloe to screen share so that you can see just a couple of shots of the sessions that we ran last year. And being from an island, of course, the island session, and you will see that on the left with Hank Rogers, who is on the board of Julie Wrigley, and we're all such a huge fan of Julie, and she's, of course, on Amy's board as well. And on the right-hand side, you can see two guests that I brought with me to the forum who just loved it. Laura Liswood, who is the chair and secretary general of the Council of Women World Leaders, all the current and past women heads of state. And Amy mentioned earlier the importance of well-being. And interestingly, it is three women prime ministers that are leading on well-being budgets, Jacinda Ardern from my own New Zealand, Iceland and Scotland. So I think it's very interesting to explore from this perspective of inclusive governance and diversity. And on the other side of Julie Wrigley is Martin Chung-Gung, who is the Secretary General of the Interparliamentary Union, the oldest multilateral body on the planet with 178 member countries. Next slide, please, Chloe. And of course, that is really important because we need to come together in coalitions to make change. And interestingly, when we look at the performance on COVID, even though women lead only 7% of countries, they were 40% of the successful responses for COVID and saved 6 times the number of deaths that their male counterparts in similar countries did. So just to put some numbers on that, in the US, had there been the same kind of response as these women leaders were able to elicit, there would have been 102,000 lives saved out of 114,000. And I'm plagiarizing Nick Kristof shamelessly, but I think it's really interesting just to see how an approach that is more collaborative and more compassionate can actually lead to better outcomes all round. So here on the screen, you have an overview of some of the partners that we have worked with since we were at the forum last year. And these partners are all helping to take the importance of SDG 5, gender equality and the empowerment of women and girls, out to their communities, particularly legislators. And Amy, I'm excited to announce here for the first time that we will be starting on climate. So that will be the next set of short video modules. These are all available online, and I'll get Chloe to put the link in the chat so that you can see. They're short 3-minute videos, but I think you'll all be shocked to know that only 8 countries in the world have even legislated for gender equality. We have a long way to go in this year of the 25th anniversary of the Beijing Platform for Action on Gender Equality. And then our next and final slide to show you some of the very practical work that we've been doing with women entrepreneurs. And this is an initiative, again, Julie Wrigley is a co-chair of this initiative with the Vice President of the World Bank and the head of the UN Secretary General's Special Gender Advisory Group. And here's just 3 amazing women entrepreneurs. It's called the We Empower UN SDG Challenge, and WE stands for Women Entrepreneurs. So often we see women just as victims, but in fact, so many women's businesses are supporting the Sustainable Development Goals and creating regenerative solutions. So on the left, Marta Del Rio from Peru, Wazi Organics, aiming to support 5 million indigenous farmers in regenerative agriculture with Andean superfoods. In the middle, Cristera Quisera from Water Access Rwanda, a 25-year-old water engineer who was so distressed by the 200 million hours that African women waste each year going to collect water, and the 400 million Africans who have no access to safe water, has created an initiative whereby she hires disadvantaged unemployed youth and brings them in to take safe water to communities, which is so important during COVID. And finally, E-Concrete in Israel. Concrete is 8% of global emissions. And Shimrit is a marine biologist who has invented a special proprietary concrete mix, which also has textured surfaces designed for each ecosystem, as you can see on the left, and is hoping to really reform the need for just plain old concrete in marine infrastructure. I could go on, but my time is up. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Amanda. I really appreciate you always have the best connections and ideas to inspiring women innovators all over the world. So thank you again. Sean Shepard is next. And Sean and Homeland Trust, as I mentioned earlier, have been with us for several forums, 3 forums now. And we got to hear from her fantastic CEO last year in the session on reforming our food systems. So thank you, Sean, for joining us again. And we're excited to have you with us on July 28th. We're going to have some exciting things to talk with everyone about, so be sure you come back while we're working together on some innovative opportunities for reforming food systems. So with that, Sean, thank you so much. Sean is Strategic Advisor Development Lead at American Farmland Trust.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Amy, and thank you to everybody who's participating today. And really, what an incredible dialogue, and I'm already excited and been jumping up and down in my head, and I'm sure other people are feeling the same way, which is awesome. I'm going to just do a couple of slides because they'll be fast, and it kind of keeps me on track. And I think for those of you who don't know American Farmland Trust, and just for clarification, so I'm sure I'm being seen correctly, are you all seeing a No Farms, No Food American Farmland Trust image?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay. Well, this is what we're most known for, is this very important tagline, which is ultimately our truth. But as we get through and talk about who we are as an organization.
To make it just a little bit more visible, if you click on slideshow.
Okay. From current slide. There you go. Does that help?
Perfect. Yes.
Perfect. Oh, thank you. Thanks for that guidance off the side. we have been around 40 years, and we are the founder of the agriculture conservation movement, really working, the only organization nationally working at that intersection of both agriculture and conservation. So we really founded that movement, have done a lot of the legislation around that movement, have really been guiding that movement over the last 40 years, and really have a vision for the next 40 as well. We take a holistic approach. We care about the land, the practices, and the people. So when we talk about that, we're talking about, you know, making sure that we have adequate land for farming in the United States. But also that land is cared for appropriately, is farmed appropriately. And we all know, because we're in this work, that not all agriculture is the same. And we also want to make sure that there are great farmers for the next generation to come. One of the critical pieces of work American Farmland Trust has done is our survey of farmland loss. And what that is loss to development, loss to urban growth, loss to rural development of manufacturing facilities, of power facilities. And our research, which is over 30 years of work, collected the most comprehensive research on farmland loss, shows that as of today, we're losing 2,000 acres of farmland every day. And the crisis point of that is that every piece of land now has to work harder. So the only way that we get better is to make sure that every part of farming is working to heal the soil, which ultimately, if you heal the soil, you heal the planet. And you'll see at the bottom our website for our farmland.org project, which is Farms Under Threat, and you can receive all the data about the crisis of land conversion. So I encourage you, if you're interested, to kind of pick up on that. But when we talk about farming is our future, we work from the national to the local. I can't say globally, Amy, but I can say nationally. But we work from the national to the local. And our focus, because of that importance of soil health, is on regenerative agriculture. And we are excited to be in the final negotiation phase to announce a fund for regenerative agriculture, which will really help us catalyze and engage farmers and ranchers all across the country in adopting regenerative practices. And those are practices essentially that heal the soil. Our goals are 600,000 acres of farmland converted by 2025. We want agriculture to be carbon neutral in the U.S. by 2030. And we also believe it's critical that agriculture become a U.S. carbon sink by 2040. Because the only way we help heal the planet is if agriculture really does its hard work of environmental services. We are the one industry that can actually do more to reverse the effects of climate change than any other industry. We also, at the national level, are working on reducing risk by expanding crop insurance in the states to assure that covers cover crops as well, which is a technique for really putting more plant nutrients back in the soil, helping build up the soil matter. And so cover crops are an important solution. We also are very excited to be working with an international partner in insurance to help cover farmer productivity losses. A lot of farmers fear going into regenerative practices because they don't know what they are. They don't know how to do it. Or they know how to do it, but they're afraid if their productivity on their land goes down, they might lose revenue. It's critically important to us that we look at the impact of the economics of farming on farmers, because the only way farmers are going to be really excited about helping heal the planet is if they know it's good for their business as well. So it is our work to make that linkage between what's good for the planet and what's good for the farmer. At the local level, really, Idaho has some of the most important productive, versatile, and resilient land in the United States. So while there's a lot of beautiful mountain land and a lot of beautiful forest land, there is a lot of farmland in the state of Idaho that simply cannot be lost. And I'm extremely passionate about this, coming from an agriculture family in Idaho. But what is really important to note is that Idaho also has the fourth largest seed growing region in the world. So saving it isn't just about saving the food that we need to produce now. It's about saving the asset that produces food all around the world. We grow 90% of sweet corn seed. And I don't know if you all feel this way, but I've got to have sweet corn in the summertime. And we grow onion seed and garlic seed and carrot seed, an incredibly important seed production in our state. So that's really critical. So that's where we work at the local level. We are staffing in the state. We are working at securing funding for farmland preservation. And our vision truly is to have an Idaho fund for regenerative agriculture as well. And so that's part of what we'll be talking about later in the month. We are here and excited to be a part of the forum, but really excited at the movements that are being catalyzed by these kinds of conversations, because we know agriculture, done right, can heal the planet. So we're very excited to be a part of it. And thanks, Amy, for inviting us to participate.
Thank you, Sean. Thank you so much to you and to the whole team at American Farmland Trust for everything that you do, continue to do to support farmers and to support our land and water and wildlife, as well as critical economies in our small communities, rural communities. So we're just really appreciative of your partnership and the work of AFT for so long, and especially right now, as we're all working to make this rapid transition to regenerative agriculture and more regionalized food systems. So very, very appreciative and really looking forward to have you back with us to dig more deeply on July 28th. Before I pass it off to our final presenter in this session, Georgie Benardete, I wanted to just mention, we've had some folks join us since the start of the sessions. Just mention that if you want to join the campfire sessions, which will follow this, the campfire sessions will be at about 2:15, and we're all going to be randomly assigned to campfire conversations where we can go more deeply, reflect, connect with each other, talk about how we're doing, what we're doing. And so be sure to email forum@sunvalleyinstitute.org and Mike will get you randomly assigned to a campfire session. In addition, during our reception towards the end of the program from 4:15 to 4:45, we have the chance to do several things. We have the chance to do our speed networking again, which we'll do during our break, during our breaks. We also will have a Q&A with our speakers from our local to global conversation, Peter Horton, Terry O'Connor, and Lisa Wing. The third option is to join a specific networking room with some of the folks who've just been updating us now and will in our next session. And so be sure to email forum@sunvalleyinstitute.org and let them know who you'd like to join, which room you'd like to join, and be sure to join quickly, because the first group of folks who get in there, the first nine folks, will be on camera with everyone and others will be chatting as well. So we'll still have a conversation, but be sure to sign up. With that, our final speaker for the session is Georgie Benardete. Georgie, longtime leader, entrepreneur, innovator, committed to making impact around the world using capital. She is a business founder of she was head of strategy at OrchardMile.com and co-founded that company. She was managing director at Multicultural Capital. I'm introducing Georgie a little more because she's new to our community. She's formally joining us this year for the first time, even though she's been part of our world helping make a difference and has a new fund fund of funds focused on sustainable development goals. And with that, I'll let her share more. And we're so happy to have you with us, Georgie. She's also a UN Foundation global entrepreneur and incredible leader, World Economic Forum Young Global Leader. I could go on and on. But so happy to have you with us formally this year, Georgie. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's such a pleasure to see you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Awesome. It's so good to see you. I'm sorry we're not in Sun Valley. Next year we'll be there for sure. So thank you so much to for everybody for being here. My name is Georgie Bernardete, and I am the CEO of Align 17. Align 17 is an impact investing marketplace, digital, that connects private capital to impact investing opportunities worldwide. So as you know, Amy, the number 17 is key for us. I believe, we strongly believe that it's only through radical partnerships that we'll be able to achieve the promise of the global goals. And now more than ever, partnership is the guiding light to bring us together to that goal. So as you know, Amy, I spent last year rolling out Align 17 inside UBS Private Wealth. So effectively, the bank is my partner, is my shareholder, distribution partner. And I'm happy to report that after a lot of traveling around the world to speak about impact, sustainability, global goals, investing, why it's important to invest in these subjects, now Align 17 sits inside the UBS product stack, sustainability product stack. So this means that whereas in the past, if you're a private wealth client and you go to any of these large banks and ask to align your investment with your values, you were usually offered the usual suspects. I call them, you know, the billion-dollar funds. And there was no chance to for the smaller managers and social, you know, entrepreneurs to have access to this to the platform of the large banks. So now with Align 17 inside the product stack, it means that finally, we can bring visibility to these fascinating managers, new themes, and just different opportunities right at the door and, you know, at the table with the world's largest private wealth bank. So it's all very exciting. And then COVID happened. And so, Maggie, I call this moment the great pause. So it's beautiful. I would love to talk to you about it. And obviously, it has been a very important invitation for me to rethink my role and to push myself to see what should I be doing. So first thing, I moved to Seattle. So I used to be based in New York City, and now I'm in the Pacific Northwest. So that was the first jump. And but coincidentally, when right before I left New York in March, the last event I attended live was the pre-launch of this book. I'm sure you all have read it. Is The Future We Choose, Surviving the Climate Crisis. So I started as a climate activist, also a banker, but I'm a climate activist at heart. And it was very interesting to see how high in the solutions trees are. So I used to be, in Align 17, we used to be agnostic in terms of which goal matters to people. The idea was, my role is to bring enough opportunities within each global goal for the client to decide. So now I'm not doing that. I still have opportunities, but I've grabbed back the pipeline into three verticals. One is climate change and all the areas of climate change, social equity and opportunities within that area, and biodiversity. So looking forward within biodiversity, as we know, we have to achieve 30% by 2030. We've lost a whole year in terms of international negotiations and commitments. So my role this year, my goal this year, is to set out an exclusive, meaning just new, just for us, just for Align 17, debt product that brings philanthropists and impact investors to support the NGOs that are doing the deep reforestation process. It's very interesting for me what Christiana says. She says that in addressing climate change, few actions are as critical, as urgent, or as simple as planting trees. So this is where I'm at. And as we know, whether you care about climate change, whether you care about biodiversity, or now that we understand what it means like to live under a pandemic, it is only through, you know, avoided deforestation or reforestation that we'll be able to actually embed resilience in the system so we don't get more pandemics in the future. So thank you, Amy, again, for this opportunity. What I'm looking is for the warriors. I'm looking for the warriors in philanthropy and for the warriors in impact investing who care about climate, who care about resiliency, who care about the forests, and who believe in radical partnerships to make this happen. So I'm going to be in the networking event, and I will put my email in the thread in case somebody wants to reach out directly if you're not able to. But again, thank you so much. It's so beautiful to be here and to in this critical moment in time. So thank you to everybody.
Thank you, Georgie, so much. Thank you for everything that you do and for joining us. And yeah, just really grateful. There are so many wonderful people in our community who are doing this work. With that, I wanted to invite Mitch back. Mitch, if you do have time and want to share a photo or two, even though we've had a really robust conversation, I did just want to offer that, Mitch, if you wanted to, or just say goodbye and invite everybody back on with your videos, and we can say goodbye, and I will, when we finish up, I'll pass it on to our next host. But with that, Mitch, did you want to share anything?
Hey, Amy. Yeah, sure. I'd love to. Yeah, it's not letting me share the screen. I apologize.
That's okay. We will send a follow-up to everybody if you want to send them to us to share on another way, whether it's, you know, another format or with a link, or you want to pop it in the chat at some point, feel free to do that. But also we'll do a follow-up with everybody and send it out. And thank you again, you guys, for joining me. So thank you for everything you do and for being part of our community. And we can't wait to have you guys back in person. I should have said at the beginning, save the date, hopefully, June 13 to 16, 2021. We have our wonderful venues reserved from last year, the same ones, and really can't wait to have everybody back in person.
So just very quickly, you know, I just want to first say that you know, the times that we're living in are, as everybody knows, are very strange, and the same holds for down here. You know, and I've been living with the Warani people in a small village over the last 100 days, and I just want to share, you know, some photographs and perspectives of the indigenous peoples. The Warani are calling this moment Wene Wene Bapa Tomameka, which means strange, dangerous things are happening. And in the Sequoia language, Painkoka, which is another indigenous nation in the northern part of Ecuador's Amazon, they refer to this moment as Koa Tekawe, which means we are living in turbulence. Mm-hmm. Beyond COVID-19, we've seen massive flooding over the last 3 months. We've seen an oil spill, which affected dozens of downriver indigenous communities. I have a rainstorm coming on right now. And, you know, for indigenous villages and for indigenous peoples, they've all lived and they live with the recent memory of disease. The Warani people, who were contacted only in the 1950s, are living with memories of smallpox, yellow fever, measles, the death of their relatives. And so when this pandemic hit here in Ecuador, the first thing that the indigenous people saw was the Ecuadorian government's inability to respond to this crisis, the medical system collapsing in Guayaquil, and it made global headlines. So what many communities did was they fled deeper into the woods, and they employed really ancestral strategies to protect themselves. Here's a camp that was made in order to self-isolate deeper in the forest. Medicinal plant medicine and food sovereignty has been really a key to resilience and to indigenous people's ability to weather this crisis. Here's one traditional practice, which is essentially using smoke and steam to protect newborns from pandemic or from disease. And Indigenous leaders across the region have been struggling to communicate with remote villages. So Amazon Frontlines has been working to support with, you know, HF radio, wireless, you know, mobile and satellite internet to ensure that Indigenous leadership across the region can continue to communicate with their villages and ensure that their communities are, you know, are able to respond properly. Also using, you know, in working to leverage and improve government response. So not only using civil society donations to provide food provisions and medical aid, but also working with the government to ensure that we can really scale support for communities across the Amazon so that they can stay put and not expose themselves unnecessarily to COVID. Working with dozens of Indigenous communities and nations to produce culturally specific health protocols. Working with the World Health Organization as well to ensure that the protocols that are being produced, you know, are vetted. Essentially, as you know, the new information about the disease and how it spreads becomes available. And we've been able to file lawsuits for precautionary measures in order to ensure that governments are adequately protecting Indigenous peoples at this time of pandemic. And fortunately, we won with the Ecuadorian government. We recently won a precautionary measures case, and we have ongoing cases at the Inter-American Commission. And, you know, this is, you know, the Indigenous elders of the Amazon are really the guides for these cultures. And, you know, we're in a time of multiple unfolding crises right now. And at Amazon Frontlines, our work is to really support Indigenous nations, not only protect their territories, but they're also their way of life. Which ultimately is going to be, you know, and is one of the most important climate solutions. And Indigenous elders are at increased risk at this time. And it's been really powerful and inspiring to see and work with the youth leadership across the Amazon right now and see how they're responding to this crisis. So thank you very much, Amy, for a little bit of time there at the end. And hopefully that was interesting for folks.
It was incredible. The chats were going. People were so grateful, and you just bring so much to perspective and insight and knowledge and a grounding to the conversations we're having. So thank you for everything that you bring to us.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. And with that, I just would note that both Georgie and Mitch specifically pointed to kind of nature-based solutions, which of course regenerative agriculture is another, and I just think the importance of the role of nature and investing in Indigenous peoples to protect those systems and teach us how to rebalance that human relationship with nature. So hope to have you back later in the summer, Mitch, and thank you again to all of you for joining us. Our next session is going to be just like this. So we are going to have our host, Eamon Storr, host it in my place. And Eamon, incredible innovator, visionary, connector, communicator. He was CEO of The Guardian North America before he founded Fair Share. And his organization, Fair Share, connects causes to companies and capital to help scale up those impacts. And so to connect nonprofits with for-profits and others who can help make a difference. And Eamon is truly one of those great connectors out there who connects ideas and people so well, like so many of our community members. So with that, thank you to our first group of updates, and we'll leave this session and let Eamon start the next. So stay on.